Welcome to the worship services of the First United Methodist Church, located at the head of Texas Street in downtown Shreveport, Louisiana. Join Senior Minister Dr. Stephen Bell as we worship this morning.
Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. He climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. And as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree and he said, "Zacchaeus, come down from there, because I'm going to your house today. Because I'm going to your house today." Yes, that was the scene in Jericho one afternoon. Jesus was passing through town on his way to Jerusalem, creating quite the buzz. The townspeople rushed out to see him, including Zacchaeus, the chief tax collector in the area. Dressed in his shiny robes made of the most luxurious textiles with impeccably clean sandals, he ran ahead of the crowd to catch a glimpse of the man that they called Rabbi. Everyone looked at Zacchaeus with disdain, audible sneers, and repulsion. No one liked tax collectors. And why should they? Zac worked for the enemy, the Roman Empire. And he was wealthy. He had a big house on the edge of town, probably paid for with the money he skimmed off the townspeople's taxes. Zacchaeus scouted the location and saw a sycamore tree. There, he would climb the tree, a perfect place to observe and see Jesus. Jesus and his friends inched closer and closer until they stopped right under the sycamore tree. "Zacchaeus," Jesus said, "come down at once. I must stay in your home today." Shocked and awed, Zacchaeus climbed down the tree. Jesus wanted to come to his home? His home? They could have gone to the diner or the country club down the block. But no, Jesus wanted to go to his home, to sit at his table and to meet his friends and family. He looked up at Jesus and smiled cheerfully. He was so honored and happy to have to welcome Jesus into his home. Before they could even arrive to his house, Zacchaeus stopped in his tracks. Jesus had given him the best gift he had ever received. Jesus called him by name when others had only called him ugly names. Jesus gave his time and his presence, and convicted of his broken lifestyle, Zacchaeus fell, confessed his sins, and fell into his identity as the beloved child of God. Well, good morning, beloved friends. We're nearing the end of a sermon series entitled Life of the Beloved, and I forgot my book, but it's based on the best book by Henry Nouwen called Life of the Beloved. And in this book, Nouwen guides the reader on how to fully live into being the beloved child of God. All at once, beloved is both who we are and who we are called to become. When our deepest truth is that we are the beloved, and when our greatest joy and peace come from fully claiming that truth, it's only natural that it will become visible and tangible in the ways we eat and drink, talk and love, and work and play. When we believe that we are the beloved, we walk cheerfully. We shine and reflect the light of Christ, and we choose joy. In the last weeks, we've spoken about our identity as the beloved and how Nouwen uses four words to describe the movement of the Spirit in our lives: taken, blessed, broken, and given. Being taken or chosen is the basis of our being the beloved. We're each stamped with the image of God and chosen as his beloved ones. No one is rejected. And as we claim our chosenness by saying yes to the gift of God's grace and live it out as our truth, we come to understand that we are blessed by God and called to bless others through our presence and our prayers. Last Sunday, we continued by acknowledging our brokenness. Each of us are broken in some way, but Christ takes our brokenness, molds us, and restores us so that we can be given. Today, we're exploring this fourth movement of the Spirit in our lives, given. And Nouwen says, and he believes, that our greatest fulfillment is in giving of ourselves to others. Beyond all our desires to be appreciated and rewarded, there lies a simple and pure desire to give. Our humanity comes to its fullest bloom in our giving. And I would argue that as Southerners, our most joyful giving is when we break bread together, when we eat together. But the joy of the meal isn't just about the food. It's about sharing of our lives with each other, the offering of hope that happens around a table. It's in the sharing of our lives with each other that we understand our chosenness and our blessedness and receive hope and healing in our brokenness. When you read through the Gospels, it's quite clear that Jesus loved a meal. Open to any page in Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, and you'll find Jesus in one of three places: on his way to a meal, sitting down at a meal, or just leaving a meal. Miracles, teachings, parables, and sermons always happened around a meal. Think about it. At the wedding feast in Cana, Jesus performed his first miracle of turning water into wine. At Matthew's house, Jesus enjoyed dinner with sinners and tax collectors after calling Matthew to follow him. In Capernaum, Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law, who promptly arose and made lunch for the Savior. On a journey south, Jesus stopped to eat grain from the grain field with the disciples on the Sabbath, and he took the opportunity to teach a lesson to the Pharisees. At the table of Simon the Pharisee, he forgave a sinner's sins. At the house of Simon the leper and at the house of one of the chief Pharisees, Jesus lunched with saints and sinners alike. And in Bethany, he often reclined at the table with Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. It was here that Jesus was anointed, and it was here that Jesus taught us to have a Mary spirit of listening and learning while living in a Martha world of tasks and projects. And then in Jericho, Jesus called down Zacchaeus from a sycamore tree. Jesus chose the chief tax collector's house for dinner, making Zacchaeus feel special and seen. Jesus called him by name, blessing him with the gift of acknowledgement and presence. Convicted of his brokenness, skimming money off the people's taxes, Zacchaeus repented of his sins. And through his repentance, Zacchaeus pledged to give to others four times what he had taken from them. On the walk with Jesus to his house for dinner, Jesus feasted on the bread of life as he prepared to make dinner for the beloved Christ. So why? Why am I talking so much about meals and food? Are you getting hungry yet? N.T. Wright, a New Testament scholar, concluded that when Jesus wanted to explain to his disciples about his forthcoming death, what his purpose and his life were all about, he didn't give them a theory, he gave them a meal. Indeed, in the upper room in Jerusalem, Jesus gathered his disciples and friends for their last supper together. While they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you." That same pattern of language of taken, blessed, broken, and given also shows up in the accounts of feeding the 5,000, as well as in the scene in which Jesus eats dinner with the disciples with whom he had walked on the road to Emmaus. Being taken, blessed, and broken, and given is at the heart of our Christian story. This is the shape of communion, the shape of the gospel, and the shape of the Christian life. Jesus used meals and tables to teach connection, reconciliation, blessing, and brokenness, and ultimately givenness. He reminds us that there's more to food than fuel. We don't eat only for sustenance. A meal together is one of the most beautiful expressions of our desire to be given to one another. And if we're called to imitate Jesus, we too should find significance in eating and drinking with one another. As Nouwen wrote, the expression breaking bread together shows the breaking and the giving as one act. Jesus broke the bread and gave it to his disciples. Jesus modeled for us vulnerability at the table. At a meal, we disarm ourselves. Eating from the same bread and drinking from the same cup calls us to live in unity and in peace. Everyone, no matter their culture, their race, their tax bracket, or gender, we all have to eat. So last February, or I guess 2 Februarys ago, I found myself in the Judean wilderness, spending the night at a Bedouin camp. And come to find out, Bedouin tribes have a practice called a sula, S-U-L-H-A. This is an Arabic term derived from the Hebrew word for table, which is shulan, S-H-U-L-H-A-N. A sula is a meal between enemies for the purpose of reconciliation. Before the conflict can get out of hand, an attempt at reconciliation is made. The two families who are involved in a conflict come together to the table to eat and to seek forgiveness and understanding. It's around the table where the walls come down and the reconciliation takes place. Eastern cultures throughout Africa and Asia, from the distant past all the way up to the present, have understood that sharing a meal together is a sign of true fellowship and connection. For thousands of years, groups have shared a ceremonial meal as a symbol of peace and mutual understanding after making a covenant. In fact, don't we do that here also? Following a wedding, we celebrate a covenant of marriage with elaborate receptions, where we break bread and connect with our new family and friends. So I ask you this, who do you need to invite to your table to give the gift of connection, to grant your forgiveness, and to instigate reconciliation? So whereas Jesus saw the table as a place of reconciliation and connection, he also saw the table as a place of blessing. Now, I think living in the South, we can appreciate Jesus' love for meals and his call to gather us around a table. I love my dining room table. When Christopher and I got married, the only thing I said I absolutely had to bring to his house was my dining room table. Everything else could go to storage or be given away, but I could not bear to get rid of my table. After countless meals shared with family and friends, my table had become an icon of God's grace and goodness. To take up a place at that table was to occupy sacred space. The people I loved most sat there with me. Our global mission team pray fervently at that table for Christ to partner us with like-minded servants all around the world. And in turn, my Haitian family and our friends from Russia, Romania, Czech Republic, Costa Rica, Australia, New Zealand, and Uganda have all broken bread at that table. Many of you have broken bread at that table. Meals were shared. Stories were told. Sins were confessed. We laughed together and cried together. Together we remembered where we had been and we dreamed of where we might one day go. We prayed at that table. And at that table we experienced God's nearness, God's kindness, and God's love. By gathering with people around tables, we can enjoy a meal as both a gift and as a means of grace. Such gatherings need not involve lavish spreads. They can be quite simple. For around a dinner table, we gather with guests and get a glimpse of the banquet of the kingdom to come. Meals are where we get a little foretaste of shalom, the wholeness of God, where the veil that separates heaven and earth seems exceedingly thin. So I ask you this, who do you need to invite to your table in an effort to bring blessing of the kingdom of heaven here on earth? And as we said last week, Jesus also saw the table as a place of brokenness and restoration. My favorite scene in all of Scripture is found in the Gospel of John, chapter 21. It was on the banks of the Sea of Galilee after the resurrection of Jesus. And after a futile night of fishing, the disciples encounter Jesus, who calls out to them from the shore. Acting impulsively as always, Peter dives into the water, dripping wet, fully clothed, in an effort to get to Jesus. As he emerges from the sea, he moves toward Jesus, who had made a charcoal fire on the beach. At that moment, he smelled something hauntingly familiar. The word that John used to describe the fire that Jesus made is the same word that occurs in only one other place in Scripture, and that's in John chapter 18, verse 18. And that's where we find Peter and the others warming themselves by the fire on the night of Jesus's arrest and trial. The charcoal fire of John 18, 18 was the place of Peter's denial. For Peter, shame had a smell, that of burning charcoal. But the charcoal fire of John 21 is the place of Peter's restoration. The simple invitation of Jesus is, come, let's have breakfast. The last thing that Jesus wanted to do with his friends before he ascended into heaven was to make breakfast for them. For the table is the place where broken sinners find connection and belonging. Despite our best intentions, we all, like Peter, stumble after Jesus. Around the table, the bonds of spiritual friendship are strengthened among believers who are walking together on the road to discipleship. So I ask you this, who do you need to invite to your table to share in your brokenness? What aroma reminds you that you are beloved? And finally, Jesus used the table as a place of givenness. This latter aspect of our identity reminds us that as God's people, we are called to be given to the world. We are called to represent him. God's mission is to rescue and renew his good and broken creation. And we are swept up into that mission and called to participate in it by announcing and embodying the love of God in Christ. Giving from our chosenness, blessedness, and brokenness is about living as God's people, representing Christ and personifying the fruit of the Spirit. We are chosen, blessed, and broken so that we can give affection for others and be loving, so that we can have exuberance about life and exude joy to others, so we can have serenity and provide peace. We are chosen, blessed, and broken so we can develop a willingness to stick with things and offer patience, so we can have a sense of compassion in our hearts and offer kindness and generosity, so that we can have a conviction that a basic holiness permeates all things and all people. We are chosen, blessed, and broken so we can find ourselves involved in loyal commitments and be faithful, so we are not needing to force our way into life, but we can be gentle, so we are able to marshal and direct our energies wisely with self-control. Yes, the fruit of the Spirit found in Galatians, which also is your memory verse for the week, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, is meant to be shared throughout all our lives' activities, but especially when we're sitting around the table. It's the greatest gift we can give to each other as we live our lives in and for Christ. Our call from God is to let others know that we are and they are chosen and blessed. And in their brokenness, they are beloved. So let us invite them to our tables to experience connection and reconciliation and blessing and teach them how they too can give their lives to Christ and to live into their identity as being a beloved child of God. For I'll ask you this, to remember these words of belovedness that the Lord offers to each of us. And I hope that you too will hear these words in your heart and then speak them to others, give them to others. I have called you by name from the very beginning. You are mine and I am yours. You are my beloved and on you my favor rests. I have molded you in the depths of the earth and knitted you together in your mother's womb. I have carved you in the palms of my hands and hidden you in the shadow of my embrace. I look at you with infinite tenderness and care for you with a care more intimate than any other relationship here on earth. I have counted every hair on your head and guided your every step. Wherever you go, I go with you. Wherever you rest, I keep watch. I will give you food that will satisfy all your hunger and drink that will quench your thirst. I will not hide from you. You know me as your own, as I know you as my own. You belong to me. Wherever you are, I will be. Nothing will separate us. We are one. Let us pray. Oh, good and gracious God, you have called us your beloved ones. You have chosen and blessed us in our brokenness so as to be given to those you place in our path. Not because we are better than other people, not because we are good or clever or strong, but because your love is free, persistent, and merciful. You have blessed us and set us apart to be signs of your love, to proclaim it, to live in the strength of it, to make other people aware that they too are beloved. Lead us into more life and to deeper wonder so that you can take who we are, bless us, break us open, and give us to the world. We pray this in the name of the beloved Son, the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords. Amen.
You've been worshiping with the congregation of the First United Methodist Church, located at the head of Texas Street in downtown Shreveport, Louisiana. We welcome you to join us in person next Sunday at 8:30 or 11 a.m. For more information about First United Methodist Church of Shreveport, please visit our website at firstshreveport.com.